Eventual consistency just says that there is a certain amount of time before all the writes have been conducted at the individual nodes, and there's a risk that we are reading from nodes that do not have the most recent write. And this paper here from 2012 tried to quantify how the chances are that we will miss one of the last writes, right? So we have n nodes, we are reading from R, and W, as before, is the number of writes that need to be there before the client gets the acknowledgement that the write was successful. So here we see how we can compute the probability that we miss reading the last write, and this is simply all combinations where you're missing it divided by all possible combinations how you can read R replicas from N replicas. So this doesn't say a lot. We have to put in some numbers now, right, to see how this behaves. And well, does this now look promising to you? So here you have quite a high probability to miss, and here as well, right, even worse. And here there's still high probability that you will make a mistake. However, if you're putting larger numbers, like n is 30, w is 10, and r is 10, then you get quite small probabilities, and of course you can stress this to get even smaller probabilities. So apparently this works well asymptotically, but not really for small configurations. And of course the question is it realistic to have 100 replicas, 100 nodes in your system? Further on, how likely is it that we get a version that is older than k versions? So that means we are missing these writes now from the last one and the previous one and so on up to k, right? And this means here we just take the probability from before and have here to the power of k. So this is like quantifying the k versions. This assumes that the set of updated replicas is not growing, so we always have the same probability even for the older writes. And if you put in some numbers, for instance, n is 3 and r equals w is 1, that means that we have a probability of returning a version within two versions of half, like 50%, right? And if you go further, within three versions, we have already 70%. So that means we are getting recent versions quite quickly, but still this is of course risky if you have such a configuration that you're really reading old information. A prominent example of a key value store is Amazon's Dynamo. There have been also re-implementations later on that became open source and used also in other companies. Amazon Dynamo is a Z key value store, has very simple operations: create, update, retrieve and delete, so-called CRUD, on a per key basis. The aim was or is to have high availability, as we discussed earlier. Basically, you should never reject a write. This was like the idea. And this can lead, of course, to different versions of the data, for instance, due to node failures, but also due to concurrent writes in particular. If you have conflicting versions, so one version cannot be just said that it's the old one, the other one is a new one, but you have conflicts of concurrent actions on the same object, then this can lead to problems you have to detect and solve. In case you have information that one version is the descendant of the other, and this can be told by using, for instance, vector clocks, then these conflicts can be resolved automatically. Otherwise, there needs to be some application logic that is doing the problem solving here. Data placement is done using consistent hashing. We will see later how this is done. So if you're building such a system and you see that you have at some point different versions of an object, of course you need to identify which versions are simply the old and the new version, so the descendant versions, or are versions which are concurrent, in which case you have to somehow fix the problem, right? As I mentioned, I think earlier, if you're having running Amazon and you have shopping basket different versions, and it's not the old and the new one, you can just take the new one, but they are concurrently modified, for instance on your smartphone or on your tablet or PC, then one solution to solve the problem would be just to take these concurrently modified shopping baskets and just take the union of the items within, right? This would be application driven way to solve this conflicting version problem. But often we can also see that a version was just an old version, the other version is the new one, and we can simply work with a new one. In order to do this, we are introducing vector clocks here. Vector clocks are more powerful than lamp or timestamps. So here we have not only one value, a time value attached to an object, but here we have a version vector. So here the vector consists of one entry for each node. So every node gets a separate counter. And in the beginning, all these counters are zero. And then if there is an event happening, like in the Lamport timestamp example, we talk about events here. And this event happens at a certain node I, then this node increments the counter, its counter in this vector. Right? And you're attaching this vector to the event or to the object. And when you're sending, you're also incrementing first the counter of your process, of the node, and then you're sending the vector along. Now, when you are receiving a vector from another node, then this is merged, this vector, with your own vector. In the following way, first of all, you are incrementing your own counter. And then for all the entries in your vector and the other vector, you go over and take the maximum at each position. This is how you're merging clocks when you're receiving an event or a message or an object. So here's an example. We have here the time going from the bottom up. We have process 1, 2, 3, and here in the beginning we see we have the sending of an event. We have here the vector 1, 0, 0. The first entry corresponds to the process 1, second entry corresponds to the process 2, and so on. Now here we see there's some event happening at process 2. So we have here the vector looks like this, 0, 1, 0. Now, if you're looking now at these two clocks, we will come to that in a bit more detail later, but if you're looking at these clocks, we call these clocks concurrent, because it is not like this that one clock is the parent or a descendant of the other clock. Right? So here we have a 1, here is a 0, that's not a problem. We could say that this clock here is smaller than this clock. However, now we have the other way around here, 1, 0, and this makes these clocks concurrent. Again, this will be defined in a few minutes. Anyway, now here is the receiving of this message. And then according to the rule from before, we're incrementing our counter. This makes it 2 here. So this will look like this. And then we are merging this clock here in this vector, which gets us 1, 2, and 0. And of course the whole procedure continues. Here also we have some event. We have another event here, the sending event. And then we are shipping over this vector clock here to this process 2. This was the old clock of process 2. Of course we have to now increment the 2 into a 3, which we do here. And then we are merging this old one and the received one into this one. And now if you're looking at these clocks, you can tell which clock is concurrent and which clock, or for which clocks and which versions there is a descendant relationship. So there's some old and new version over multiple steps or one step. So here's how you're comparing two clocks. Of course, two clocks are identical if they are identical in all of the entries. One clock is said to be smaller or equal than another clock if it is smaller or equal in all the entries, also quite intuitive. And one clock is strictly smaller than another clock if it is smaller or equal. And there exists one or more entries J for which the clock 1 is strictly smaller than the clock 2. And now we also define what it is to be concurrent. The vector clock 1 and the vector clock 2 are said to be concurrent if and only if it does not hold that one is smaller than the other or equal, and also not the other way around, that the clock 2 is smaller than clock 1. Then these two are called concurrent. So to illustrate the use of vector clocks in a distributed system, in order to see which messages or which versions are a parent version or which versions are conflicting versions, here's an example story of a communication between friends, Alice, Ben, Kathy, and Dave. They're planning to meet next week for dinner, and they now try to plan the dinner, where to go. So this is taken from this URL here, in case this is still active. Okay, so the planning starts with Alice suggesting they meet on Wednesday. Later on, Dave also exchanges email with Ben, and they decide on Tuesday. Then Dave discusses alternatives with Katie, and they decide on Thursday instead. Now there's more text, but let's have a look at the first part, what this means. So first of all, Alice sends an initial message proposing Wednesday. And you see here we have the entry Alice in the vector has 1, and the others are assumed, if not mentioned, that they are 0. So we have the vector clock Alice has an entry of 1. And the date in this message is Wednesday. So now, in the text, as I said, Ben and Dave start talking, and Ben suggests Thursday. So, but only to Dave. So that means we have here Ben suggesting Tuesday. And sends this message to Dave, and you see here the entry is Ben with a 1, because Ben now just got active and did something. And of course we keep the Alice 1 entry, so now we can see that this clock here was aware of this clock here, right? This is like the idea how we can follow where a clock comes from, right? And now you see already the problem coming up, because Ben did not involve the others, only Dave. And now there's a risk, of course, that it can be concurrent decisions. So now Dave replies confirming Tuesday. So now we have the clock here, which is also shown here at the top. Alice won, Ben won, and now also Dave won, because Dave now sent this message. Now, if you're looking at the clock here, or this one here, we know that now this clock also includes the information or the history of the message of Alice and also Ben. So by looking at this large clock now, we know that that Dave was aware of Ben's message as well. He was aware of Alice's message, right? Now let's go on. And now Katie is suggesting Thursday. So look what Katie knows. Katie is here at this position. Katie has received the information from Alice. So this initial message here proposing Wednesday. And sending this information to Dave, right? Only to Dave. You see now here that Katie's clock A1 and C1 is not having knowledge about Ben's decision, and also does not know about the decision that Dave made after he has received Ben's message, right? So this, of course, now is inconsistent. Now we go on and can compare these vector clocks to see why this is a problem. Because now Dave has the following clocks. This clock here and this clock here. One clock saying Tuesday, I mean one information saying Tuesday with a vector clock Alice1, Ben1, Dave1. And the other clock saying Alice1 and Katie1. Now the problem is that neither clock descends from the other. That means we have here Alice1, Katie1. Here we have Alice1, Ben1, Dave1, and of course Katie is 0, as it's not mentioned here, but we assume 0. So this is not smaller or equal than the other clock, and the other way around also not. So this is like a concurrent situation now. And this is a problem that needs to be solved somehow in real world or in your application. And now Dave can resolve the problem by simply choosing Thursday and then updating the clock into Alice1, Ben1, Katie1, Dave2. And now this clock tells us that it is a successor of the two previous clocks. If you go back now, you see that this clock here is larger or equal than both of the other clocks, right? By merging these clocks and incrementing here, of course, the counter for Dave. And now when you're sending this clock around, then everyone knows that this clock is a reconciliation of the clock sent around earlier. Right, so here we have now this clock that Dave is sending back to Casey. So Casey then knows that Dave has incorporated her clock in a clock by Ben earlier she was not aware of. So now Ben informed Alice about Tuesday, Dave informs Casey and Alice about Thursday, and now Alice gets two different proposals, one from Ben forwarded and the other one coming from Casey via Dave. And now this is what I mean here at this position. Now Alice will see these different clocks, but then we'll see that there is no problem because the clock here coming in the last step from Dave is larger or equal than the other clock sent by Dave. So this is not a problem. Everyone is happy. This is mentioned here. So we are done. This is like the solution. Alice will notice this and can broadcast this clock, the final one, to everyone else, and they can go for dinner on Thursday. So a conflict happens if we have conflicting versions of the same object slash item. Here in the example, we talked about finding a dinner place or dinner time. These were the objects, and we have different versions, meaning that we had different days proposed and they could not be, or they were not, let's say, in descendant relation, so we had to solve this. The database has, of course, a hard time solving this automatically. In our example now, Dave would just look at these proposals and then merge somehow and make the decision for one of these proposed days. In a database, there's limited information and limited possibilities to solve this automatically. In case we know about that one is the descendant of the other, we take the most recent one, of course. But in the case they are in conflict, this is not really possible. We can still take the most recent one, but this is not not so clear what the consequences will be for your application. However, if you're writing a client software, so you're operating with a key value store, but you know that you want to implement a shopping basket at Amazon, then you can solve this in a meaningful way for your application. And as I said, in the example for Amazon's shopping basket, you would probably just take the union of the items in the versions that are in conflict. Right? This is what is written here.